I recently made a video covering the Snowball Earth mass extinction event that occurred 700 million years ago. However, there may have been an even bigger, even older mass extinction event nearly 2.4 billion years ago. And that is what we'll be talking about in today's video. This potentially largest mass extinction event ever, and the tiny microorganisms we think are responsible. Just to start with some background information, if you haven't seen that Snowball Earth event video that I just recently posted, oxygen is present and abundant in today's atmosphere, making up about 21% of the atmosphere, and is also pretty abundant and well mixed in our oceans. However, this has not always been the case on Earth. Before about 2.4 billion years ago, Earth had very little to negligible oxygen in its atmosphere and oceans. It wasn't until about 2.4 billion years ago that oxygen concentrations began to rise in the event that we call the GEO, or the Great Oxidation Event. Oxygen concentrations at this time are estimated to have risen to near modern levels and then rebounded kind of back down to low, variable to potentially uncertain levels throughout the next billion-ish years until we get to the second major oxygen rise in Earth's history called the NOE, or the Neoproterozoic Oxygenation Event. This occurred around 700 million years ago, just before the Ediacaran and Cambrian explosions of life that led us into the current Phanerozoic eon, in which oxygen levels have remained relatively stable relative to, you know, the GEO and NOE events. But what caused these events and why were they so drastic? Well, the GEO was caused by the evolution and spread of photosynthesizing cyanobacteria. Oxygenic photosynthesis, that is, photosynthesis that produces oxygen as a byproduct, had not been around on early Earth, and then by the time it evolved and spread widely enough to the point that it could start building up free oxygen in the atmosphere and oceans, it caused the GEO, this great rise in oxygen concentrations. The NOE was also caused by evolutionary advancements and increased spread in photosynthesizing organisms, namely algae, but also other factors like tectonics and continental breakup, which I talk about more in that Snowball Earth video, as well as my NOE video where I discuss all the causes of the NOE. It's a very old video, but it's still great, and it talks a lot about isotopic and chemical evidence if you're interested in more details, so I'll link that up here for you. But the GEO is what we'll be focusing on in this video, this more old 2+ billion year ago event that caused the first and potentially largest mass extinction in Earth's history. Obviously, we can't get to the devastation that this event, well, both of these events caused, without first talking about the fact that it wasn't just devastation, they also caused major evolutionary advancement. It's probably not a coincidence that eukaryotic life and multicellular life evolved at times very closely associated with the GEO and NOE events. Obviously, oxygen is required for oxygen respiration, and oxygen respiration allows more complexity and larger sizes and more functionality and multicellularity of life because oxygen respiration provides more energy than any other metabolic pathway. I talk about that a ton more in my video, How Life Got Big, which I'll link up to the top right for you. I'm sorry I'm linking all these videos instead of explaining it. It's just that I want to get to the actual topic at hand, which is the mass extinction event that we're talking about today. Obviously, both of these are associated with mass extinction events because they both mark rapid and drastic global change. We're going to be focusing on this early mass extinction today, the GEO caused mass extinction event. The extinctions at this time were caused in part by rapid cooling and global glaciation due to rapid and global decrease in atmospheric CO2. We call the glaciation events associated with the GEO and NOE Snowball Earth events, but as I discussed in the Snowball Earth event one, the most widely accepted data for a potential Snowball Earth, or kind of two Snowball Earth events, is associated with the NOE. The data associated with the GEO for glaciation is a little bit more spread out, and it's harder to make a case for a global snowball Earth event for the GEO, the older 2.4 billion year ago event. However, that said, there was still obviously rapid cooling and glaciation. We just don't know exactly how widespread it was. But this wasn't the only thing causing mass extinctions at the time. It was also the rise in oxygen itself. Before the GEO, before oxygen became really a thing that was abundant enough to use for metabolism like we do, we breathe in oxygen and we gain energy from that, all the life before that was obviously not using oxygen because it wasn't around, and therefore it was what we call anaerobic life. We are aerobic organisms. We breathe in oxygen and we use that to respire, to metabolize, to gain energy. Anaerobic life, microbial anaerobic life, was the only thing really around other than phototrophs, things that use light to gain energy, before the GEO, before the rise in oxygen. And anaerobes obviously don't need oxygen to live, but there are many anaerobes that also are what we call obligate anaerobes, in which oxygen is essentially toxic to them and they do not want it around. They will die if it's around in any, you know, capacity. I cultured microbes in the lab for a long time using anaerobic microbes, obligate anaerobes, and they would die at any whiff of oxygen. And so a lot of the life that was dominant and widespread before the GEO was this kind of life. So you can imagine when the GEO hit, when oxygen rose to these drastically high concentrations compared to the pre-GEO Earth, it caused nearly 90% of species to go extinct, which is an estimate based on a relatively incomplete fossil record because microbes don't preserve as well as like big skeletonized and shelled life that came along later. And so it's really hard to put numbers on extinction events that happened so long ago. So it could be more than this. This is likely an underestimate given the life that was around pre-GEO and what the GEO represents, that is the rise in this toxic chemical, which at the time it was toxic to this life. So if this 90% is an underestimate, this could mark the greatest extinction event of all time. The end Permian mass extinction event is said to have wiped out 96% of all species on Earth. This has a couple caveats. One is that this is kind of two combined events, the end Guadalupian and the end Permian event, which were about 8 million years apart, and people often combine them into one big end Permian period event or end Paleozoic event, which obviously would then be the 96% of all species on Earth. However, this number is also calculated using macro fossils, not necessarily thinking about the microbial biosphere, which is the one that we're considering when we're talking about the mass extinction event associated with the GEO, because at the time, all that was around were microbes. So if we're talking in terms of microbial life, 90% of microbial life, that is probably more than when extinct at the end Permian. But again, take all of the numbers in this particular video with a grain of salt because quantitative biological numbers from the Precambrian are really hard to nail down because the fossil record's so incomplete. However, anaerobes weren't the only ones affected. Cyanobacteria themselves also went through a major decline. One, they were kind of living in a world that was filling up with their own waste, essentially. Oxygen is their waste byproduct, and it was filling the atmosphere very rapidly. But not only that, they were also using up all of their nutrients because they were kind of new on the scene and they were rapidly spreading. And so due to a use of all their nutrients, they kind of went through this feast to famine scenario, which caused primary productivity at the time, in other words, their photosynthetic activity, to decrease by over 80% directly after the GEO. When we're thinking about this event and the potential impact that cyanobacteria had on themselves by producing all this oxygen, it's important to remember that today, oxygenic photosynthesis is balanced by oxygen respiration. So
trees and other oxygenic photosynthesizers use carbon dioxide and produce oxygen, and we humans and other animals respire that oxygen. We take that oxygen back up and convert it back to CO2, and it's this cycle, converting oxygen to water and vice versa, and converting organic carbon to CO2 and vice versa. And this is a balance of the carbon cycle and oxygen cycle. And back then, cyanobacteria were photosynthesizing, taking the carbon dioxide, producing the oxygen, but organisms weren't around yet to balance this cycle. One, they weren't around yet to take the byproduct out of the atmosphere, the oxygen, and respire it. And two, they weren't around yet to regenerate that CO2 that the photosynthesizers need. Now, it's important to note that CO2 wasn't necessarily a limiting nutrient at this time. It was really abundant in Earth's early atmosphere and still was at this time. It was more likely that nutrients like phosphorus and nitrogen became very limiting, and iron became very limiting to these organisms, and that was what caused their crash in terms of feast to famine. But it is also important to remember that there was a lack of this balanced cycle. This lack of balance also led to extremely slow recovery compared to later mass extinction events. If we think about the big five mass extinction events that I've talked about in many of my videos, these are the ones that we have a bit more of a fossil record for because they occurred in the past 550 million years. In other words, they occurred in a period in which we have large macro fossils for, so we can quantify their impact a bit better. And what we see with these big five mass extinctions is recovery after each extinction. This is a graph showing biodiversity, and each major mass extinction, you can see a drastic drop in biodiversity and in global biodiversity by number of genera. And then you see a relatively rapid rise or recovery of that biodiversity after each event. And to the point that you see even greater biodiversity after some events like the KPG. However, biological productivity and diversity remained seemingly low for the next billion years in Earth's history after the GEO. This billion year period is actually nicknamed the Boring Billion because of an apparent lack of geological activity, biological evolutionary advancements, or chemical changes in the rock record, indicating a lack of climatic perturbation as well. However, is this really the case, or is this just how it seems? Again, given a lack of preservation of microorganisms in comparison to more macro fossils that have shells and skeletons and preserve a lot more easily in the rock record, the Boring Billion is difficult to interpret because at the time it was mainly microorganisms. But major evolutionary advancements, as well as potentially major tectonic events, were also occurring at this time that were continually uncovering with more research into that billion year time gap that make that Boring Billion a lot more exciting than you may think. And so if you want to hear more about the Boring Billion, you can check out my whole 25 plus minute video where I talk all about whether it was really that boring.
So if you want to check out that video about the Boring Billion, where I go over all of the things geologically, chemically, and biologically that happened during that billion years, or at least the things that we know of, to some extent. I will link that up here for you. And with that, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you guys next time. Bye.